Welcome, everyone, to today's forum on in-town parking concerns. I'm Peter Morrison with the Nantucket Civic League, and we're delighted to host today's forum. The Civic League's mission is to promote the general welfare of Nantucket through informed citizen participation in community affairs. Our league represents, I think at last count, 25, is that right, Charlie? Neighborhood associations, neighborhood area associations, and we have roughly 2,000 dues-paying members, so it's a broad outreach into the community. Today's program is designed to inform you who are the attendees today and the many more island residents who are going to view this on demand in the weeks ahead, thanks to NCTV Channel 18. I'll now turn the program over to our moderator, Civic League Co-President Charles Stott, to introduce today's speakers.
Well, thank you, Peter, and thanks to all of you for coming. Just a reminder, if you miss anything, this will be rebroadcast periodically on Nantucket Community Television Channel 18 and will be available for your viewing upon demand. So welcome to our television audience as well. For those of you who have not yet done so, we have surveys at the back of the room. If you would like to pick one up and complete the survey, we would very much appreciate your input. This is a survey on parking options that might be available in the near term. We have some well-qualified and interesting presenters to offer varying perspectives on the thorny issue of downtown parking. And I'd like to introduce them. To my far left is Selectman Matt Fee. Beside Matt is Dave Fredericks, representing a Harbor Place project. He's the manager and the owner's representative. To my immediate left is Michael Burns, the transportation planner for the town of Nantucket. So let us begin with Dave Fredericks, if you would, please. And thank you for coming.
Thank you very much for having me, and thank you very much for putting this together. I think it's phenomenal for the community to be able to get together, continue to talk about this complex issue. If people don't mind, I'm going to stand and look at the screen. And so I apologize for those in the audience. I just think that it's easier for me to see what you folks see as I talk. Thank you. As we talk a little bit about it, I continue to suggest that it's important for people to understand what Harbor Place is. Harbor Place is a collection of owners, which include National Grid, they include NIR, and they include Winthrop. Remain has been involved throughout this process, but because the bulk of where we're focusing now is really doesn't include the property that we know as Greenhound, which is under their control, their role is really interesting in that it's evolved into wanting to play a significant role in the discussion about transportation. As you know, one of their missions is for overall improvement of transportation, in particular the downtown area. So their role has changed a little from the beginning. When you look at the site, one of the things that's always helpful for me is to remember where the site has come from. As you stare at the screen and you look to the far left, that was the late 30s or late 40s, I apologize. The middle screen is the late 50s, and the far right is the late 60s. And what you see on the site, it was very industrial by nature. It had coal gasification equipment, tanks at one point spread out in the 40s all over the property. Then they were centralized into the 1960s. And for many people may be aware of it, the particular site that's downtown now with the tanks on it will be has a license through 2019. And that license expires, and Harbor Fuel is working to relocate that tank farm to a piece of property that would be out of town, out near the airport. Today, the way the ownership works out, just in general terms and what's down on the site, we have the parking lot that we all call, I still call the A&P parking lot area, regardless of what we think of, but it's really privately owned, and it's associated with the A&P, which is the number two. Tank farm is number three, and number eight is a series of commercial stores. All of that is really owned by Winthrop, with small pieces of it owned by Nantucket Island Resorts. The remaining property, number 7, is the original building that was built in the late 1800s by then Nantucket Electric Company, and really, for all practical purposes, the location of the first generation on the island. Next to it is number 6, which is the substation that we're all familiar with. Number 4, number 5 are all part of the open space that's really remaining. Number 4, for those who want a little bit of history, was built in the late 40s, and it's where the coal gasification itself used to take place. When we looked at this, one of the things that we tried to do was, and we spent the better part of 2 years thinking about, was there a partnership here between all the owners that could make sense for everyone involved and for the community. There was a real work at trying to find a balance. And we tried to consider strongly all of the transportation issues. We had real zoning issues that we had to contend with. We had floodplain issues. And for those of you who aren't familiar with it, the Army Corps has recently, as about 4 or 5 years ago, came out with a series of issues that each community had to deal with. And one of the things was to deal with storm surge. And one way they dealt with that is they layered out floodplains and they set elevations and minimum elevations that you have to build in. And those are starting to affect everything that we know down along the water and in the waterfront. So one of the unique things we have to do is think about elevations for anything being built on the site that is owned by this group. It has to be, in many cases, 4 to 5 feet above what we see today is finished grade. We had Chapter 91 issues that have to do with open access for the public to the waterfront. We had environmental issues because, again, Nantucket Electric's property was a 21E site because of the coal gasification and because of cleaning up the old power plant. We also have what will have to take place after the tank farm comes down, which is whatever remediation has to take place for that. We have to think about how we are going to approach public hearings, how we're going to get the public feedback. And then lastly, we had to think about how we start to get boards and other people that are valued in trying to come up with the right long-term solution. We reached out to the selectmen and the planning board last fall. They were worked with us and put together a small joint committee, which is some of the selectmen, some of the planning board, and all of their joining staffs to start to talk about how something like this might come together as a partnership between the town and the various owners. When we're done, and I jump to this because I really want to make the second half of this about a discussion about transportation, which we came to the conclusion was the element of the project that really was going to become the cornerstone of how you go forward with the site. But the way we see the property, very simply, is if you, and I'm going to go from the water side out. When we look at the property, the first thing that we wanted to do was provide a clear access to the water to bring everything that's happening downtown, including our site, to a clear connection to the water. We also wanted to send a message to the community that we understood that under the Chapter 91 regs and under the relationship that we're looking for, that needed to be something that was clear, that we knew that obligation was there, and we wanted to find that solution. So we just call this area, which is about 100 feet by a little over 400 feet, or just about an acre of property, our waterfront connection. One of the thoughts that we have because of the elevation, and again, this is one of the thoughts we look at, is that we might have a wider road, a more public access driven road that we know today as New Whale, green space on the water side and some elevation on the non-water side. The idea behind the non-elevation is it first helps deal with the Army Corps' issue to have some elevation adjustments to deal with the flooding, but it also allows this kind of upper tier level where you can sit and do outside dining, or you can sit at a park at a bench and enjoy the water view and not be necessarily caught off guard by the traffic that might be going by. The next element we thought was critical was the market. We believe the market is important to downtown. In this particular plan, we move the market to the corner. We believe it needs to be open more. It needs to be very much linked to the commercial activities that are related to people coming and going, to what we think ultimately is part of the answer, which is a transportation center. We also, because of the housing issues that exist on the island, plan to put affordable housing on the second and third floor. And this is meant to be workforce housing, that 140 AMI type housing. The next element, which we'll get into and I'll show you a slide in a second, is all about the pedestrian access, all about the bike access, all about making that experience to be able to walk throughout the site and be able to use your bike and to have access to all of the things that are happening downtown. So we believe road design, the width of the streets, the width of the sidewalks, the characteristics of that area are just critical to making the site work. So one example is to think about something as an example like Straight Wharf, where you would end up with a lane that is completely dedicated to, as in this particular picture, and again, we're not saying that any decision has been made that it has to be tour vans or pickup vans or any type of thing on one side of the street or other, or taxis on the other. We're simply saying that by designing a road that allows to use both curb lines for dedicated purposes, that in the long term, we can add some real value to how the traffic flows in the general area. What you also notice in these slides is a 10-foot sidewalk. When people are coming and going, we've all run into this, we have luggage, we maybe have in my case, I have my granddaughter with me, and I'm able to navigate everything if it's a little wider, if the surface is designed, thinking about that access working for everyone. The piece that's critical for the owners is that they be given some understanding as to how they can go forward with a mixed-use development. The idea here is each of these blocks would have parking built within them, so they would not be adding to the parking. And ultimately, this is the piece that we would call the development. The next piece is the piece that I think is critical, and it's what we're here to talk about, is the idea of a transportation center. We look at it, and many people have said to me, oh, you want a parking garage? And I continue to say, no, I'm not after a parking garage, and the project is not saying that a parking garage must absolutely go there. But when you get done looking at everything the town's done to date and everything it's considered to date, certainly a parking structure, along with all of the elements that we're talking about from sidewalk improvements and traffic flow improvements, but as well a transportation center, then we think that this could become part of what could be a long-term solution to help soften some of the parking and traffic congestion issues that we see downtown. When we looked at it, these are all the different elements that we thought we had to consider. And I continue to point out, for those of you who have not done it, the town itself has done a tremendous amount of study work on each one of these areas. And for us, we were thinking that we would be out hiring experts to fully analyze the site. What we found was the town had done much of the work that we needed, and most of our discussion came to back refining what the town had already done. When you look at the site, one of the things that we really recognize is if you straighten out the sidewalks, if you allow the patterns to flow with very specific purposes, so there is not chaos, so that there's a loop for transit, there's a loop for commercial vehicles, there's a loop for pickup and drop off from the boat, there's a loop that then allows you to come down along the water. All of those things ultimately build into all of the elements needed to make this area work and interface with downtown. The parking structure itself and the way that we've drawn it, which is quite literally the first set of drawings, and it was really meant to show the town, again, what becomes loops that can allow people to come and go off the property in ways they never did in the past, to be able to leave the property without having to cross Main Street. And none of these are written in stone. What these are is meant to show the size of a structure. Many people have said, can't you make it smaller? Can't you make it this, that, or the other? We're proposing to the town a footprint. We're proposing to work with the town so that they can design what works for their downtown area in conjunction with their planning process. But in our minds, here are some opportunities to understand, you know, why does it have to be a certain size? It has to do with how the garage flows, how parking turning radiuses work, how do you make the elevation from one floor to another work? What else we believe is important is the transit center part of it. So our suggestion is to take the older building that is on the site today, again, built in the late 1800s, and convert that into a pedestrian area that people can come and go, be out of the weather, wait for transportation, or wait for their loved ones, or whatever it may be, and in the back half be something that focuses on transit. That can include anything that you can think of. It could be ticket offices for the High Line and the steamship if you wanted to grab your tickets in one place. We've not gone out and convinced them they need to do this because the community has to go through this process of deciding if a transit center with these elements is important to them. But it can include offices. It can include a satellite office for tourism if that's important. The point from where we stood was we're laying out an opportunity to expand to have additional space downtown focused on all these various components. The way you pay for this is that the majority of these types of programs, if you're improving these types of situations, can be through grants. There are many state grants, federal grants, and new mechanisms throughout the government that can allow you to gain access to the majority of the money needed to be able to construct something like this. We put at the bottom the recent example of Plymouth. Plymouth started about 7 years ago. They funded a $20+ million garage almost exclusively from these grants with very little money from the taxpayers. What is a transit center? And I think that's the question that I would leave everyone with, is it's more than a parking structure. It can be anything that we as a community want to think it can be. We can bring the NRTA hub to be something that can be more than it does today. It can deal with weather issues. It can allow for, again, all of the various other activities, such as airliner ferry tickets to be picked up so you're not running around the community. It can allow and maybe become a place that also allows supplemental vehicle or bicycle or boat rental, anything that someone wants to be able to come in and be able to have one-stop shopping and not be circumnavigating the town with their car. It can be an experience for the tourist. We can do things and deal with some of the things like shortages of bathrooms on one end of town. We can deal with a place where, you know, one of the things that I've heard is when you talk to the group that runs a tourist center is that the volume at times is so great and being able to break it up would have some value. So it allows opportunities for the town and its planning to think about things that never had that opportunity. And it certainly allows some focused discussion and commitment to how the town might want to deal with parking options. So what we're providing at the end of the day really is an opportunity for the town to say, here's almost an acre of property. And as you think about how you want to solve these problems, we're trying to provide space so that you can eliminate that from the discussion and start to ask yourself, how best can we make this better if this property is available for some type of solution that makes a difference to our community, to how traffic flows, to some of the issues that we have downtown? Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much, Dave. I'm sure that many of you have questions or comments that you would like to make, but we'll get through the four presentations first, and then there should be ample time for you to weigh in. I'd like to introduce the Civic League co-president, Peter Morrison, to review the results of a survey that we conducted. First, let me explain the genesis of this survey. We got together, the Civic League and the Town Association, to discuss options, particularly with respect to downtown parking. And we reached a consensus on six different options that could be implemented perhaps in the near term, as opposed to what Dave just presented is further down the horizon, but six different options that could be considered in the near term. And we felt it was important for us to first take the temperature of our member organizations before we take a position. So that's why the survey was distributed to our associations so that they could ask their members to complete it. So now that the survey has been completed, Peter will review the results.
Thanks, Charlie. I should say that Charlie is really the one who spearheaded this email survey on several proposed ideas for dealing with the problems right now that we have. And I would ask you to think about these options and the opinions about these options as suggesting how we might begin to move toward a future like the one that has been outlined by our first presenter, that of an intermodal transportation hub. It's going to take 15 years before something like that truly gets realized. And so we've got 15 years or 14 years to try things out and see what seems to be working and whether some of these things could be fine-tuned and shaped in a way that would lead into the concept of a transportation hub that would make, that would really smooth a lot of things out going forward. Let me give you a little background on this. The pilot survey was sent to members of several of our town associations, and the sample includes residents both in town and outside of downtown, such as Matticat and Surfside. We don't have a truly representative sample of all our communities or all our neighborhood associations, but we think we've gotten to the two different types. And those of you who are attending today were invited to add your own voice by completing the same survey. And now that hopefully you've done so and handed it in, we're going to give you a chance to see what people have said thus far. What we have are six proposals that you see summarized here. I hope you can read it all. And this is the consolidated sample of all 247 respondents that from whom we heard. To the right of each proposal is the distribution of responses, which ranges from strongly agree, to no opinion, disagree, strongly disagree, and you can see that they total to 100% plus or minus one percentage point for rounding. I want to start by telling you that a pilot survey like this has many limitations, which I won't go into, but what it can reveal are the broad contours of opinion, and as Charlie said, taking the temperature of the community in terms of what's worth pursuing and what seems to be pretty much divisive within the community that doesn't really look like it's as promising. I've highlighted what I see as one clear pattern. It's not the only one, but it's the clearest pattern that emerges, which is for the shuttle bus to satellite parking. And as you can see, the portion that I've highlighted in the gray area, this idea receives strong support with 55% strongly agreeing, another 30% agreeing for a grand total of 88%. So nearly 9 out of 10 people who responded said they were in favor of something like this. Now, if you look to the right, we see on the converse of this, there's only 5% disagreed and 1% strongly disagreed. So got most people, the vast majority of people seem to favor this, and there's hardly anyone who doesn't like the idea. So that's the kind of pattern we're looking for in this sort of a pilot survey, something that is a clear contour. We can clearly say this is something that wouldn't be opposed by many people and probably would be favored by many people at town meeting. Now, just to contrast this a bit, if you look at the two paid parking proposals, either the bumper sticker or the window sticker, you can see an outlined in the dotted lines here, there's a fairly substantial percentage of respondents who oppose these proposals. Admittedly, there are about as many who seem to be in favor of it, but these two proposals would be examples of ideas that seem to be pretty much dividing the community into those in favor and those opposed, and not really a consensus at all. You can pick up a copy of this table along with the responses from the different neighborhood associations as you walk out, and you can ransack the data any way you want. I would just leave you with the thought that there's one important caveat that you want to keep in mind that applies to all of these. These opinions may or may not reflect the respondents' own willingness to participate. For example, I might be very much in favor of a shuttle bus to satellite parking for all those other people, but I myself, I wouldn't use it very much. So that's something we really don't know. And we can't know unless we probe further and ask people, not just, do you think it's a good idea, but how often would you use it? We don't know that yet. So with that caveat and the inherent uncertainties of pilot surveys, I invite Charlie to introduce our next speaker, Mike Burns, who can talk further about the details. Thank you.
Thank you, Peter. When we started looking at the issue of parking downtown, the first person that we turned to was our next speaker, Michael Burns, the transportation planner for the town of Nantucket. Michael?
Thank you. It's always nice to be invited to come speak on these kind of issues. It's always good to get these kind of information out to the public. I think what I'm going to try to do is show how a lot of the policies and recommendations of the Nantucket Planning and Economic Development Commission, the Nantucket Planning Board, and the Nantucket Board of Selectmen try to align, how all these different initiatives align. And that a lot of these recommendations exist in this document that's up on the screen here, the document that was approved in July 2015, the Regional Transportation Plan, which also serves as the circulation element of the Nantucket Master Plan. So this is the community's vision for how they would like to see the community grow over the next 30 years. And I hope I'm speaking into the microphone correctly and everybody can hear me appropriately. There was a discussion about survey results that the Civic League initiated. The planning office initiated similar surveys over time. This is an excerpt from the soon-to-be-updated community master plan. This question asks, should the town of Nantucket develop a year-round public transportation shuttle? You just saw some of the results of what the community felt like, something like 77% in the Civic League survey, or 70% in the Civic League survey. Our survey shows 77% of the community likes a year-round transit service. So that not a whole lot of differentiation there. When asked the question of how would you pay for some kind of system like this, I think it was something in the neighborhood of 40% in the Civic League survey. We can see here that it's something like 40% like paid parking as a tool to use to finance those kind of systems. So not a lot of disparity there. So just trying to demonstrate that the Civic League survey definitely aligns with the results of our kind of surveying material. So we have a very good feel of what's going on in the community, what they like, and how they like to potentially pay for these kind of initiatives. I'm a planner. We love numbers. We love looking at maps. I'm going to show you some. This is an excerpt from the Regional Transportation Plan. This shows the map below. Where does the community live? This is year-round people in Nantucket based on 2010 census. Where do you live? Where are we distributed off the island? You can see it's around the schools, around the Bartlett Farm area, and definitely around the airport, Boulevard, Fairgrounds Road area. This is the concentration of the population where everybody lives. How do we get to where we go? Again, these are commuters. How do we get around? We drive alone, about a super majority. Two-thirds of the community drive alone. How does this compare nationally and statewide? You can see that we're better here. This is a little bit more of a bike-friendly community, pedestrian-friendly community, transit-friendly community. Even though Massachusetts itself is very friendly itself, Nantucket does a little bit better job, but it doesn't. We don't lose the point that still majority of people like to use their cars and they like to drive. That said, how do we address parking in downtown, being that that's, you know, a center of activity, center of jobs? How do you address that? There's really three points that I'm going to hammer on in this as we go through these next slides. One is parking management. That could be paid parking. But we call it parking management. Second is increasing parking capacity, and that can be done with a number of different ways, either through a parking structure or through satellite parking lots in a park and ride. The third item there is increasing public transit. Saw the survey results on providing a park and ride service, the satellite lot service, and year-round transit service. We'd like to do that. Where do these ideas come from? Right around the time that the community was doing the Wilkes Square study, you all may be familiar with that work. It pretty much aligns very well with what's going on at Harbor Place. The NPNDC took a vote to recommend to the Board of Selectmen implement essentially these three measures: implement paid parking downtown, investigate development of a parking garage in the vicinity of the what we call the Warwick Square area, but essentially the Nantucket Electric and the Harbor Place area. And the third is implement a direct shuttle through the park and ride system. So again, all of these initiatives and policies, they're all aligning. How did the Board of Selectmen react to this recommendation on September 15th, 2010? They recommended those actions, but with the understanding that not all of this is totally figured out and ready to be implemented, need to be fleshed out a little bit more, and I believe that's what's been going on in the meantime. One of the things that needs to be figured out in the meantime is how to finance a lot of these transit improvements. And then this past October, then PNDC took a vote on in a way to implement year-round service and this park and ride ferry connector, park and ride direct shuttle service. Do that and look at three different ways. Again, with a downtown parking sticker. There's other ways that I'm going to talk about in a second, but recommended this bumper sticker program. The NRTA could also increase fares, and that's something else that has been looked at this fall is doing a feasibility of what that actually looks like and how much revenue would be generated by increasing fares. And then increase the embarkation fee, which again was another question that the Civic League asked of the community. It's a tool that's in place now. We do need authorization from the legislature to increase this. I believe in this past the governor's approved and the state approved a municipal modernization bill that some of you may be familiar with or have heard about. One element of that municipal modernization bill was a regional ballot initiative that was going to give communities the authority to increase fees such as these that at the last second that didn't actually pass, but that's another tool that could be used. We do have to seek authority to use that tool to increase the embarkation fee. So that's a little bit of background and history. My cover slides show the regional transportation plan cover. I'm going to crack open that book and go through some of the contents of that and bore you for about 30 seconds if you'll just struggle through that. We do have in our goals and objectives for the NPNDC manage the use of cars in Nantucket while providing a safe, convenient, and economically sensitive transportation system, sensitive to the characters of the island. At the top of that list on these different emphasis areas, and how do you actually do that? Three of those are parking management, which we've already talked about, multimodal, again, public transportation, bicycle use, and pedestrian activity. And then recognizing that we do have a need to get on and off island, and the ferry connector park and ride service was intended to address that. Cracking this open a little bit deeper, we'll talk about parking management. How do we do that? It's in our goals, and this is an objective, is to continue to evaluate alternative parking permit systems in the downtown. Identify peripheral parking areas. This would go to the satellite parking and the parking garage as areas where we would need to look at, and assist the town when developing a paid parking strategy. You hear these ideas, and I'm just trying to show you where these things live in a bureaucratic document. So thank you for bearing with me on that. paid parking, what's been looked at up to date? Nelson Nygaard, along with Remain Nantucket, financed a study to, try to understand what a program downtown for paid parking would actually look like. This is the kiosk system. The question was asked by the Civic League survey, do you want to manage parking via this type of system? It was looked at in February 2011. This is on the heels of the NPNDC approving that three-pronged approach for addressing parking problems downtown. This is one of the policy documents that came out of that. It has not been accepted just yet. They did their analysis, came up with a bottom line total of what revenue would be generated out of this effort that could be used to finance public transportation and all of these other programs that we all see as beneficial. About $600,000 that would be generated out of that effort, but again, this is a kiosk system. As far as another parking management tool, this bumper sticker program, this was looked at back in December of 2006. And again, at the end of the day, there would be none of the time regulations that would be forgiven. This is the exact regulatory system downtown. However, it's treated more of as a beach sticker program to where in order to park downtown, you would need to purchase, and we just estimated a $25 sticker, just to pick a number. What would be a willingness to pay for something like this in order to access downtown to park. The revenues that would be generated to that out of that effort was about $500,000, something like this. So these are two parking management approaches that we've looked at, and thanks to the Civic League for surveying the community, we have an understanding of how popular it was. And I would say, for the record, probably the sticker program is not a heck of a lot, but slightly preferred over putting kiosks and on streets in the downtown area. Second approach, increased parking capacity. Dave just went through a very good presentation of the Downtown Transportation Center. I think he made a very good point of how it's more than just a parking structure. It's actually a place for the shuttles to locate, how we can provide information to the community on other modes of transportation. The area around the center would be somewhat pedestrian friendly with cafes and the such. How can it be more than just a parking garage? Well, it absolutely needs to be more than just a parking garage. There's other multimodal demands that a facility like this can address. It was initially looked at, this was a study for the Wilkes Square redevelopment, was wrapped in September 2010, about the same time the NPDC was embracing this three-pronged approach. And now we're starting to see some kind of refinement of those ideas as part of this Harbor Place development. But out of this the study with the parking garage, just to make a side note increasing capacity, right in downtown in the core area, about 300 spaces, a walkable area of downtown all in, there's about 800 spaces. We did an evaluation. Is that sufficient or not? A lot of us will say no, but what is that number? We figured it was something in the vicinity of 300, 350 spaces, approximately, educated guess. Along with these solutions, with a surplus of parking that's created out of this Harbor Place development, coupled with the offset of demand for parking by relocating that demand outside of town into satellite lots, two fairgrounds is one of those satellite lots, capacity of 80 spaces now, we'd like it to be 200 spaces. You start adding these together and we start to address that parking problem. We've started to address that 350 number of deficient spaces to address, and we've tried to address demand, moving it around geographically and accommodating it in the vicinity of town. Here's the location of the two fairgrounds lot. It's 80 spaces now, right behind the two fairgrounds lot. It could be expanded to 200 spaces here, and this would be, another way you'd address the parking capacity as one of the legs of that three-pronged approach. The third leg of this approach, increased public transportation. One way was the ferry connector service. Again, this was first evaluated back in March of 2008 that study was finalized. Maybe a lot of you attended some of those meetings that we had at the Athenaeum and other forums where we tried to survey the community on what the community wanted. We heard we need to make biking in and out of town a little bit better and improve that with wayfinding. That's been implemented. The ferry connector service here, that was implemented as a pilot project, and what's going on now are sidewalk improvements in the downtown area. Dave mentioned making the downtown a more pedestrian friendly area, more bike friendly area. You start to shift these modes. I showed you that pie chart earlier in the presentation of 65% of the community drives alone. If it's a little bit more friendly to bike there and walk there or take the bus there, maybe we eat into that number a little bit and you address the demand that way as well. So there's a number of different ways of tackling this. The ferry connector, when it was implemented, again, this was a route that went essentially from the airport along Old South Road to the two fairgrounds park and ride stop, 80 spaces now, preferably expanded to 200 spaces, and then on into town. And that's come to be a success. I think it's been tested the last 3 years. It's been very popular. The lot's been full, so that's been a success. The year-round service, that was evaluated this past a couple of winters and implementing a service. The pie chart that I showed you with the 65% mode split service, I also showed you a map of where we all live. We all live here in this area. That's where the route that was recommended for year-round service. A lot of us live along Old South Road in this corridor. Again, those were the red areas of the map I showed you earlier, and that's, again, it's not a huge reach to find out, you know, if we're going to address year-round population, this is where the year-round population is. A lot of these are existing routes, and the price of this right now, we've been estimated it to be almost about a $500,000 solution, which if you looked at some of the other parking management strategies and revenue generators, these things do kind of start to correlate and start to come together. How do they come together financially? I'm sorry to show you this big confusing chart. I tried to color code it, but I'll walk you through it. Over on the very far, far side along in this white area here, this is the existing NRTA system. That's funded through federal state aid, through local aid. You know, this is about a $1.3 million operation. That funds existing now. If we were going to expand it, you know, the community mentioned that they had wanted to see some kind of satellite system, this ferry connector lot. That's roughly about a $300,000 system that conforms. I show 121 days here. That 121 days is the span of time of downtown parking regulations. So that's why we picked that 120 days. $300,000 for to run that system. Off-season service, this is essentially your year-round service. And that area of just the around the Barlow Road school area and along Old South Road, that service, you know, again, roughly about 500,000. So you see what your demand is. The bottom line, you have about $800,000 in additional transit service that you would need to fund to address these needs. How popular are these? Well, the Civic League survey shows 88% favorable for these satellite systems. 70% of the community. Planning board, the planning office would tell you that 77% are favorable to year-round service. How to pay for it? Well, let's go down this far left column. Increase in the embarkation fee. The Civic League asked the community, about 57% were favorable. What does that generate, raising the embarkation fee by just 50 cents and assessing the commuter charges? That generates about $280,000, not quite what you need to pay for this, so a little bit of extra funding would need to be found somewhere else. Down at the very bottom of the yellow area, doubling of fares, that was something that was been looked at as probably a good strategy to do to pay for, say, the year-round service. We say that, you know, it's about $380,000 would be generated out of doubling of or increasing fares for through the NRTA. Well, that doesn't quite address the year-round problem, so there's still a gap there. And this middle band of yellow through the downtown parking, number one, I didn't look at the kiosk option. That just looking at the surveys of the Civic League and talking to other people anecdotally, most people don't want to see equipment on the downtown sidewalks. A sticker on a car, which is a very Nantucket-centric thing, charging $25, generate roughly $525,000 out of that generation. That would pay for the year-round service, and with some residual funds left over for the satellite parking. That coupled with, say, just spitballing, coupled with an increase in the embarkation fee, that achieves that goal, that paying for it out of those programs. There's also the idea of charging for overnight parking at the two fairgrounds lot. I mentioned earlier we'd like to expand that to 200 spaces, being conservative and assuming that 80% of that lot was utilized during that time frame of parking regulations, we would get about 19,000 users. We figured the paying threshold for overnight parking is about $10. It's half of what they charge at the airport. It's definitely a lot less than an overnight parking fee in downtown. It generated almost $200,000. So even that's not a unique one solution. So there's got to be some combination of these solutions to meet this $800,000 threshold. I will note, and this is that if the parking sticker wasn't $25, what would it need to be if that was the sole solution? Say it was $38. Everybody that drove and wanted had a demand to park downtown paid $38. That would actually get you to the amounts that you would actually need to fund those two programs. Is that the willingness? I don't know. One other strategy, and again, this is just for illustrative purposes, went through an exercise. This isn't something you can do in Massachusetts, but if one asked themselves, what do other communities outside of Massachusetts, how do they tackle this problem? Most of them do it with a increase in sales tax. This is something that you're not It's not done in Massachusetts. Again, I mentioned the Municipal Modernization Act, and one of those authorizations that allowed a community to increase fees locally to pay for certain. It's not allowed right now in Massachusetts, but it's came close this last year. But just for the exercise, and another caveat, this is something that NPDC has not supported, but if you did increase the sales tax, other communities use a ratio of, like, say, 0.6% or 0.5 or 0.4. If ours was 0.37, based on our retail sales in recent years, that not only addresses the ferry connector operations, the year-round transit operations, but also we can look at existing service, and that starts to get addressed here with the local town contribution. That starts to equal out. So that's just being demonstrative of how different sources can fund different aspects of, say, this third approach of increasing public transportation. So that summarizes a lot of what we tried to go through. We tried to conform and correlate the survey results of what the Civic League did, and present you with the different options that we've looked and strategies for addressing parking downtown. Again, it's not a there's no free solution for some of these initiatives, but I think we've identified a roadmap to where at least we can get to the point of where we address parking deficiencies, and hopefully we can get a strategy for financing this that's, again, within the tolerance of the community.
Well, thank you, Michael Burns, for a most informative presentation. Before I open it up to questions and comments, we'd like to get the perspective of a member of the Board of Selectmen, Matt Fee. Matt, thank you for joining us.
Yeah, thank you very much. A lot of my perspective has been covered, but I'll go through my list. First off, the Selectmen, we understand the importance, but it's of parking and, you know, downtown parking and all these issues, and it's tough to address. There's multiple stakeholders. People are set in their ways. People, you know, they don't want to change how they do things. It's only 2 months, and they don't want to pay for it. But it's something that we've been working on and we've been chipping away at. Sometimes it seems like we haven't done anything, but you know, a fair amount has been done. You know, we've funded more money for sidewalks. There's the overnight trucks out of the downtown. We've been working on that. The ferry connector, we've worked with the steamship and the High Line Stop and Shop. I keep calling them Finest, but Stop and Shop, and they helped fund the ferry connector those first years. We're going to expand the fast ferry lot that Michael was talking about. That's going to be, we actually voted that last Wednesday, I believe. We're fixing sidewalks. We've just fixed a sidewalk at Easy Street. There's out-of-town bike paths have been improved. There's been road improvements, First Way, Boulevard. And some of those things are expensive. Like, those are very expensive to do. The fast ferry lot, if you really think about it, is an expensive solution. It's the town land, but you're giving up the future use of that. You're giving up, you know, a lot of value there. So we have to think about that. We've negotiated the relocation of the tank farm, so that that's going to be a big help. So, you know, we are working at it. But again, it's difficult. And then we have to realize that a lot of this is growth driven, and that's going to give me the evil eye. I'm not looking at. And the growth is good, but every house is 2-point-something cars. You know, I was the crazy person that thought we should limit cars 15 years ago. I'm still, you know, I understand the political difficulty of doing that, but I think we have to be thinking, you know, we have to be thinking of how do we do it, and we're getting there. But we can't ignore the fact that our roads downtown are a certain width, and even if we go quicker on Old South Road and quicker through the roundabouts, you still hit a bottleneck somewhere. And when I talked to the consultants, Nelson Nygaard and the group that was here before them 15, 20 years ago, this was all, like, sort of that congestion was all projected. We all knew it, and we knew what it was going to be, and it's happening exactly where they said it was going to happen. It's happening faster and it's happening worse, but it is happening. And so we have to come to grips that it's, you know, not just 300 spaces isn't going to fix it downtown. You know, it'll help, but the demand for downtown parking is bigger than the consultants have seen anywhere else they've ever worked. And they've been in Cambridge and Mass, and they've been in Boston, and they've been, you know, Denver, Colorado, all over the country, all over the world, and they've said they've never seen demand for parking as great as they've seen on Nantucket. So that just sort of, you have to keep that in our head. I'm glad that Peter, I had a few points about the survey, but Peter Morrison hit most of them. I think we have to just realize that there are limitations with a survey. People, first off, the survey is not much different than what we were saying 15 years ago. We all want things, and we want someone else to change how they do things, and we want someone else to pay for it. And we want to continue to do things the way we do them. And you can't, you know, it's sort of, we all have to be part of the solution. You can't, you can't think that the rich people will pay and they'll buy the parking garage for us and they'll all park in there and we can park in front of our desks all day. You know, that's kind of magical thinking, and we have to, you know, sort of put that to the side. In a survey, it's not always right. It's what is politically possible, you know, so I think what Mike just laid out is really good short-term steps, which is what we're here to talk about. But we have to, you know, recognize that a survey isn't always right. And a simple example is the school housing. They asked the teachers what kind of housing they wanted, and the teachers all wanted three bedrooms and this and that and the other, and that's what they built. And the same thing, I think, happened in Sherman Commons. And lo and behold, no one wants to rent them. They're too expensive. So you have, you know, so there has to, you have to take the survey and the information and understand its limitations, which, you know, and then add numbers to it and work with it and come up with something that is workable. So those are kind of the general, just a general selectman standpoint. From my standpoint, you know, I look at it and say, what has to happen? I think it's complicated, but we have to look at the whole transportation system as a whole. We have to think about buses and walking and cabs and, you know, Ubers that are coming, and all those things have to be in vehicles. They all have to be looked at as a whole in a parking garage. It has to all be examined together. And that's number one. Number two is, I think part of why this takes a while is there's no boss. You know, in my business, it's something natural. If I have five bosses, the five people in charge of the bakery for a day, I have no one in charge. And I think part of why we're having trouble with transportation is that we don't have anyone in charge. You know, like Mike will have, you know, Mike can come up with great recommendations. It comes to selectmen, and the selectmen are just as split sometimes as the community is, so they don't get implemented. And 10 years go by, and, you know, so somehow we have to break that logjam. And I think the only way you do it is at some point make it administrative, have someone along with a board potentially who looks at all of these issues as one thing. And when they do that, they have to value parking properly. Those parking spaces are really valuable downtown. You know, I don't know what the number is, but we're looking at taking a couple spaces in order to do some of these, and it'll be interesting. They're going to be $50,000-$80,000 for a parking space to buy one. And so, you know, and when they were, and this is like 15 years ago, it was somewhere between $3,000 and $7,000 to have a space for the summer. When that one summer, we increased enforcement, and so people were using the behind the Dreamland, and, you know, Island Gas, whatever it was there, and those spaces were really valuable just for a summer. People were paying $5,000 to park, have a place to put their car, and not get tickets. And so, you know, we have to, as a town, value those properly. And, you know, if we did this, part of it is how do you get people to get in a parking garage if they can't if they can park next to their desk for free? You know, why would you want to go into the parking garage? Well, you have to actually make the more convenient, you know, this is sort of the demand management side of this. You have to make the more convenient places more expensive, and you make the parking garage cheap or free. And so you have to think that way. If you go to places like, Northampton, Mass. The parking garages on the outskirts are free, and then you come a little closer and they're, you know, $5 for the day, and you park on the street and it's X amount, you know, first 2 hours or two is free and X amount. We have to actually accept that you have to think that way. And then what you have to do is change those change those prices and change the enforcement of the prices to make sure that a certain amount of the space is always open. And, you know, if you do that and spaces are open, then all of a sudden you've got flow. People can, you're not driving around town looking for a space. So we have to be thinking about it in those things. We have to simplify the enforcement and the rules, right? If anyone watched the Wednesday night selectmen's meeting, we were talking about the parking, truck parking downtown. The trucks are parking all around downtown, and how do we change it? Well, it's a regulation here, and it's a bylaw there, and we have to do this, and we have to do that. And when are we going to get it done? Well, we can't really get it done until next year, some of it. And I'm looking at saying it has to be easier than that whenever we do it. We have to put as much emphasis on the alternatives as we do on cars and trucks. We need to get the down, the, and, we, and, we've, and it's in our reports. It's something we say that we want to do, but we really need to do to actually put that there. And then the final thing, which, and this is kind of what I think is kind of the fun thing, is we have to embrace sort of the technology that's coming. If I look around this room, and average age is probably, I don't know, what my age, 57 years old. We're all old. We look at cars completely different. And there's a couple of youngsters, I see you, but we look at it all completely. But the average age is probably a young 57. But we have to look at the, you got to look at it differently. Like, we can't be scared of the technology, the things that are coming. My kids, they don't even know what a cab is. They call it an Uber. They think that it's, you know, they think it's a new idea, a new technology. The technology is new, the idea isn't. I could talk about that forever. But the interesting part is, it isn't just a cab company. The companies like that now, they're bringing the traffic down. In the cities that they're popular in, what's happening is, instead of someone driving somewhere to get someone and driving back and getting two trips, they're getting in and taking one trip, and then the car goes somewhere else and takes somebody else. And so all of a sudden, you're seeing drops of 30 or 40% in certain places. They're now doing shared rides, and it's all cloud based. So people, you push the button, and you want a cab, and or you want an Uber, you want a ride, and then they'll say, oh, geez, there's someone else. You know, Dave needs a ride the same time, the same area. Great, I'll pay half as much. We'll share it. So all of a sudden, instead of two cars driving us, you're down to one car, and so, you know, taking that same trip. So there's things, and it's happening. It's incredible. The driverless cars. We all think that that's the Jetsons, and we're never going to see it. And it's happening now. They've put millions of miles in, and it's actually, they're safer than people driving. You know, the largest for kids, young kids, 25 or so, they're the largest chance of death is in a car accident, up to like 25 or 30. The biggest chance of dying is from a car accident. You know, a million people a year die in car accidents. And so, you know, things like Uber and Google, it seems crazy and far out there, and it'll never happen in Nantucket. But I think, you know, there's some real positives that we shouldn't push away just out of hand, and not be scared of the technology necessarily out of hand. And then also realize that the younger people now, they want the service of the car. They want the ability to, you know, a car's really expensive, you know, but if you need it, you need it. But it's shifting, and it's going to shift even more over the next 20 or 30 years. So the question becomes, they want the service of that car. They want to be able to go from A to B. And if they can do it, if they have to own a car and all, and the maintenance and all the other stuff, then they have to own that. But if they don't, they'd be just as happy not to own it and have that service when they need it at a fair or even cheaper price. And I think that is going to continue. And so from a, you know, big picture selectman's perspective, I think when we're looking at the, you know, $30, $40 million, $50 million we're going to spend over the next 10 years to fix Old South Road and, you know, potentially buy a, you know, build a parking garage and manage it and do a bunch of other things, you know, part of me looks and says, are we going to be building something that in 30 or 40 years, 20 or 30 years is going to be obsolete? You know, so we really should be thinking long and hard about the real big ticket items and saying, is there a better way to do it? If you can, if the biking were easier and safer, you know, that would take X amount of people out. If there was more ride sharing and things, that would take X amount. And maybe we won't have, you know, my goal, not goal, but my dream would be that, you know, every house that is built doesn't take, need 2-point-something cars. That every house is, you know, we start building, you know, densely, and all of a sudden they don't need a car at all because it's already here and it's there for them, or it's bringing us one car or a half a car per dwelling, you know. So I think those, and that part, it's kind of interesting to me. So, and I'll kind of wrap it up, and if there are any questions, I'm sure we'll be doing that soon. Thanks.
Okay, thank you for your very thought-provoking comments, Matt. And now it's your turn. We have about a half an hour for any comments, brief remarks, or questions for any of our panelists.
And if you would, step up to the mic because our TV viewing audience won't hear you if you're speaking from your seat.
Mr. Wagley.
For the chance to get a chance to talk here, I've been dealing with this subject for 40 years, and please shut me up. You said we had a half an hour. I could talk about this for 5 days. But just a couple of observations. And as Dave Frederick said, when he was talking about Wilkes Square, this is complicated. It is complicated. And he was talking narrowly about that. I was thinking, what about the rest of the historic district? But this is a lot less complicated than we often think, and a lot more complicated in many ways, because part of this parking issue is tied to another issue that we have tried to solve it, or been solving it, by one of the worst programs across the United States or in any developed country, by turning our sidewalks into parking lots. And we got to get rid of the sidewalk parking. That's another subject, but it's very important in the solution of this thing. I talked to Matt earlier, trying to figure out what are the number of places in downtown historic area for parking. I had a figure of 712, which I thought Matt and Mike both mentioned 300. Maybe it is 300 public parking spaces. But once you get there, some givens in this kind of thing. And I was a traffic person in Georgetown area of Washington. We got the first residential parking system in the country, and we had to go to the Supreme Court, fight it through there to get it, and that's why we have the sticker parking here. But this is not that old in the United States, but people have wanted it for a long time. And these solutions are there. They're outside. We just listened to what everybody said tonight. The answers are all here. It's just a matter of doing it and getting someone to carry it through. Matt was talking about car sharing, things. I've got an article I've translated from a French magazine, which I'm trying to get permission to put in the Inky Mirror, about the car sharing, the many solutions to this they have in Europe. But you can take a couple of things that are givens, that if we've got 312 or 700 public parking spaces in the historic area and the business area and surrounding, one of the it here, like Georgetown, like all over the country and in Europe, is a commuter problem. It is people coming in to work in stores here, bringing their cars and taking one of these 300, 700 parking spaces, whatever. There simply has to be, whether the selectmen do it or not, a regulation that if you draw a salary inside the historic district, you do not take up one of those 300 to 700 public parking spaces during the day, or it's a $500 ticket, whatever it is. We had a variant of Matt and Mike Burns and I were all on the committee, I think 2006 or something, the auto limitation. And we came up with a $25 ticket. It was shot down because both papers at that point said, no, that's like a tax, even though it cost $75 for most people to fill their gas tanks at that time. But that's kind of a given. You've got to get the commuters, the people who work here, not to take up. And the going figure for that, which we had in Georgetown and elsewhere, if you work in a store on Main Street, you come and take one of those spaces, you are depriving your store, your employer, and the other ones around you of 7 sales per day. That's an accepted figure. And when we got the thing in Georgetown, the businessmen and the students sued because they didn't want the sticker parking. It's private property. It went to the Supreme Court. We won. That's why we have it now. But the within a week after the thing went through and the parking was restricted, the businessmen turned completely around and said they thought it's the best thing since sliced bread. I've talked to them now, and I suggested to a couple of business people here, if they wanted them, I'll get in touch with people there, say how well this works. But that's the number one thing. Employees do not take out. You know, we know they shift cars during the day, and that causes a bit more traffic. But that has to be enforced and rigorously, or a culture of it. And this is, you know, you start from there. And the same thing, well, with sidewalks, and you get part of the thing, you've got to start from the beginning. You are either going to have sidewalks that people can use, whether tourists or residents or whatnot, or you're going to have parking on. You can't have both. And you can walk up and down any of the sidewalks in town now. And I did a survey of India, Huzzy, Gay, and Quince streets, all the residents on this. This was one of the questions. There is not one person surveyed that either has not been fallen and been injured themselves on those sidewalks or knows someone that has. And more than 50% of the time, they ended up at the hospital. The sidewalks, this parking on the sidewalks is intolerable. It has to go. But that makes our problem more complicated. But we got to make a choice. Either we're going to have sidewalks in downtown, or we're going to use them as parking lots. But you can't have both. Anyway, that makes things simpler if you start from that. But you guys, I mean, Matt, you, what you're talking about is what's in that article I've got from the French magazine. I'll get it to you, as I promised I would.
Thank you, but, Mr. Wagley.
Thank you.
Mr. Young, you're up.
Thank you. I want to start by thanking the Civic League for putting this together and for you guys coming and doing this presentation. I think it's awesome that you're working on this. On this stuff. I just have a couple of quick comments and then maybe a question. I loved what both Peter and Matt were saying about the surveys, and I wonder how many people take the surveys, use the satellite shuttle, and use stuff. So I appreciate that you're looking at the surveys with maybe not all being black and white on that information. I think if you're going to park on a historic downtown Nantucket, there should be some kind of fee for that somehow. I don't know how you collect it. I have been in places where they have these kiosks. I don't know that a couple of kiosks in Nantucket would take away from the historic character of the town. I think for the kiosks, I would have a four-word solution. Put shingles on it. And then I have a question. I have property downtown near the waterfront, and I look uphill from my grade to the Steamship Authority parking lot. I look uphill to Broad Street. I look uphill to the Dreamland. And I'm concerned if there's a large area like where the old ice plant parking lot is now. Would they build above the grade, or would they raise the grade? And if we start raising grades in town, I would love to get the grade over at Broad Street raised up.
Thank you, sir. Any reaction from our panelists?
So, Harry, in response to the question about grades, the idea with the way these buildings get built, the building gets raised, parking ends up underneath the structure themselves, the road itself that cuts through, in some cases, The roads themselves, like New Whale, and the roads that cut through themselves get raised about 4 feet. The buildings themselves actually stay the same. You're parking underneath them, but they have the appearance of being taller. So there is some land mass added, but fractionally it's a small percentage of the overall footprint. If you took a look at the footprint of the power plant as an example, it used to be there, and you added up the impact of what the roads are, I think you'll find out it's actually less mass on the site. And the idea by doing this, it allows the water to still move through without really impacting other areas. But that's going to be one of the complex issues that has to be developed through the permitting process. And I think it's one to be very sensitive of. I understand your concern.
Thank you. Yes, sir.
My name is Howard Dickler. I live in Tom Nevers. I have one comment and one question. My comment is that I very much agree with Mr. Fee that you ought to have to pay for convenience. And if there was fee parking downtown, I think the problem of not finding a space would take care of itself. My question is, several times last summer, I attempted to park in the Washington Street lot, and there was never a space, and it was primarily occupied by trade trucks, day and night. Would somebody please comment on that, and what could be done about it?
Who wants to take that, Matt?
I'll try to tackle that. That whole issue... there was unintended consequences. The goal was to get the trade trucks out of that parking lot, and they're not allowed to be in that parking lot in the summer, and get them out of downtown parking overnight. So we were enforcing from, and Mike, correct me if I'm wrong, but it was like 2 a.m. to 6 a.m. So we were going around in the trucks, because the first complaint when I got on the board 6 years ago was with people around Lola and Harborview. Is there were box trucks and cars parked there overnight all weekend long. They'd leave on a Friday, Thursday or Friday, car would sit all the way till Monday, the guys would come back. And so that's when we said, okay, you can't park downtown. But in the midst of saying commercial cars can't park downtown, one of our selectmen who's has a commercial truck says, geez, that's not fair to the island commercial guys, because what if they come and have a couple pops and have to leave their car. They're doing the right thing. What if the police, so we left a loophole in, which, sort of was easy to predict at the time. And so what happened is, if you had a commercial car truck that was a residence, it was okay. If you got a sticker, say, come out here and get a sticker. And the next thing you know, a lot of the off-island trucks were now residents. They had someone vouch for them and get a sticker. So this just shows, in my mind, so we're closing that again. We're working on that again this week, trying to close that loophole. But in my mind, that just shows you the value of these spaces. And we, as a town, this is where I keep going back to, we need a boss. As a town, this is too much to have planning do once every other month, or the selectmen do one of their three meetings. There's a lot to it. And so I think that's, we understand the problem, and we're attempting to address it.
Other comments or questions? Yes, sir.
My name's Dave Feindel. A couple points. One was the concept of needing, I hear the space. I hear parking garages or increasing parking places, but when you do that, you lose the use of the property. But again, if the thinking was, when anything goes in on top of any land, especially if it's a public building, are we really emphasizing to go underneath it? I mean, we just built schools with a lot of footprint there that could, I'm not sure how they can go far, they can go down before they run into a water table or something. And hospitals, are we taking advantage of that precious square footage? Even though, yeah, as a school, they say, well, it costs more money to do that. But as a town, we're talking about garages or parking lots, where it seems like if they're putting in a foundation, how much more would going down another tier, putting it in, don't even finish it, but make it so you could lease parking garage it or something. And even with the parking lots behind where we are right now, can't you do it with that kind of concept? Go under, prepare for it. You could even stretch it, maybe even in streets and things like that. That's one concept that I think we were missing on that kind of thing. The other one is, do we need to limit cars in some fashion, which has come up it's a very touchy topic over years, but what, Bermuda? Don't they have something like that where they either prevent cars from coming on? If you do, you can't drive them. Or you make downtown not drivable during certain hours of the day so that you have some impetus to say, well, I haven't got an option to park right in front of the store. I have to go to a parking lot and take a shuttle in. And it takes that decision out for somebody who has to make that decision. Those are a couple points.
Thank you. Reactions?
Yeah.
You want to react to the underground?
So the I talked a little bit early on about some of the considerations that the owners had to look at, and one of them I mentioned was environmental. Certainly on the National Grid property, and I think when they're done doing the remediation of the Harbor Fuel property, there are limits when you're dealing with 21 E-sites as to the ability to go down. The cost to go down becomes astronomical compared to anything that one might imagine when you're dealing with remediated sites. And so one of the concerns for everyone was that they would find ways, what you typically do on these sites is you remove the hotspots, the known causes, and then you go through all kinds of different options depending on which choice you choose. The National Grid's case, they basically circulated the groundwater and continued to filter out the contaminants till the water hit a certain point. But what they don't want to do is get into trying to dig extensive amounts of dirt, which they then have to manage as hazardous waste, and quite honestly could change the cost of the project, you know, 7 and 8 figures in a heartbeat. And so it was considered. It wasn't practical. I was involved, and I'll change topics a little, I was involved and put a lot of personal energy into the elementary school. And we initially got involved probably 3 years ago. The elementary school was going to be one floor. And one of the first things we realized was the impact of the footprint. And so we did analyze going down, and we did analyze going to a second floor. We think we struck the compromise for what the community could afford. I think there is more and more thinking about the value of going down. But again, it is a premium. And so we had gone through our process as a building committee and chose to go up one floor, which was another step forward to minimize footprint. And that was as far as we could bring ourselves to justify the economics. But it was considered.
Thank you, Dave.
Matt? I also spoke to the hospital when they were in their building and planning process, and the same things apply. Some of it's they can use that space. That space is valuable for other uses, but I think it's a cost. It was for them. It was a cost issue. It's very expensive. It's $50,000 to $60,000 per space to build a parking garage, even underground or something like that. The other thing I wanted to bring up real quick is, you know, if we don't do anything, you know, that's an action. And so that was one of the questions I asked 10 or 15 years ago to some of the consultants. Well, geez, what happens if we don't do anything at all? If we just, you know, continue to add cars and cars and widen the roads and eventually, you know, what happens? And they go, well, what happens in a lot of communities, sort of pick Aspen, Colorado, and places like that, is they close a road, they close two roads, and they close parts of their downtown, and then eventually then the traffic is so backed up that they turn around and they'll take one road inbound and one road outbound, and those will be for cabs and buses. So, you know, that's the, you know, unless we embrace the alternatives, that's where we're heading. We're heading to a, you know, to say, to picking, you know, maybe it ends up, I don't know, pick a street. Washington Street becomes the truck route and cabs and buses, and everyone that wants to go into town has to use some other streets. I mean, that's where we're, and we'd have to close parts of downtown. That's traditionally what happens if you choose to do, you know, sort of embrace the way we're doing it now. And I think that just as there's a huge incentive in my mind to look at, you know, to work on this and to spend some more money on the NRTA and to fix the sidewalks and to do, you know, and look at the transportation and invest money in it.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Dillon?
Hi. For now, I think that for a short-term solution, I think we need better enforcement downtown. Many times this summer, I would see two of the cops, Cub Scouts, whatever you want to call them, walking in pairs, and I don't see how that's effective enforcement. And also the restriction of construction. It used to be that people honored this June 15th to September 15th downtown, and that seems to have been thrown out the window in the last 2 years. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Hi, my name is Justin Taylor. I'm a founder of a community on the island called Young Creatives. So it's like 20 and 30 year olds. And so we often have conversations about our role in the development of the island and stepping into positions of leadership. I wanted to kind of reflect back my experience today and see if it maybe helped us, well, to see what that furthered. But I felt like we had like a for-profit business and, you know, Civic League, which I think is just a community organization, and town employees or town. And I find that like part of the conversation was, okay, we have an idea. We have a vision for this transportation hub. We have the kind of constrictions or restrictions that come from lack of funding or access to funding, and maybe some steps that could get us to afford temporary solutions to problems that may change in time without leadership being in place to really figure out what the scope would be 20 or 30 years from now. And I think it's a really good opportunity to look at how to incentivize for-profit businesses to fix the problems that our island has. So if you can find, if the transportation hub can be a for-profit center that's looking at how we can implement ride-sharing in a way that both creates money to be able to improve the economy, right, but also solves major problems the town has, looking at the development of mobile apps to be able to ticket or be able to pay for parking in town, right? You don't need to have a station necessarily. Tons of cities have mobile apps and you just check into a square or space. It's not visually intrusive, but you have to kind of incentivize someone to want to create that product knowing they're going to be returned. But I think there's a lot of economic return that comes from businesses like that being created on the island outside of just, you know, retail or real estate. And so when you kind of have these people together, I feel like I saw the mix happening. I was trying to figure out how do these organizations connect with one another in a way that really supports them so they're not working in desperate directions on the same problem. And so I don't know if I have like a suggestion or a question, but I kind of want, I see that often in the things that are happening here, affordable housing, you know, water quality, the incentivization of for-profit businesses to come and solve our problem, I think would be really good. And you have a for-profit organization or project that's already here, that may be a great way to spearhead some of those solutions coming up, especially with technology or having leaders step up.
That's a great comment.
Charlie, can I comment? It's a really interesting idea that you threw out there, because when you think about the kiosks, that we don't like the look of them downtown, how many years are we away from having a virtual kiosk where you can just say, I want to buy the privilege of parking downtown for an hour in some vacant spot. I'm spending my $20 or $10 or whatever. Here it is. And that leads me into another point, which is there's a distinction that we're talking about here between hard infrastructure, which is this vision 15 years from now of an intermodal transportation hub and everything else that goes with it, that we have to start thinking about, well, what would it look like and what would we be building? And the other side of this is, are the market mechanisms that don't require infrastructure, they just require fine-tuning, that price the privilege of convenience that we all want to achieve, so that we can say, I want to go downtown. I want to think of it as I'll pass through the downtown and the probability of finding an empty space is about 90%, so I'm not going to have to double through a second time. How can you clear that process by pricing so that I'll know that in advance? And Mike, in one of his slides, I don't know which one it is, had a really interesting summary of the kinds of fees and things that were being contemplated, or, you know, what could pay for what. And what struck me in virtually every case was how modest those fees were. By one calculation, you had something that would allow me to pay for the privilege of parking downtown with some kind of a sticker that would be roughly 10 cents a day. And I was thinking, well, how about a dollar a day? I think it was the... Well, let's start with the embarkation fee. What are we talking about there? 50-cent increase on people getting on and off the boat with a car, was that what it was, or just getting on and off the boat?
Correct. Well, right now, there's already a 50-cent surcharge for tickets leaving a port community. If you increase that by another 50 cents, so call it a dollar.
Fair enough.
That
gets you a quarter of $1 million. Parking sticker, that's the one I was thinking of. $25 a year, is that?
Sure.
Divided by 365, that comes out to less than 10 cents a day, doesn't it, by my arithmetic?
Sure.
What about $250? If I'm a year-round resident, I say, well, how would you like to just be able to go into downtown and know that you can park there? Mm-hmm. Great. Maybe I don't want to pay $250. Maybe I want to park somewhere else. I mean, there are all sorts of mechanisms. And the point I want to make here is that we've got 14 years to tinker with these kinds of ideas. We can bring out a slate of two or three innovative ideas here, try them out for a year, see what happens, see what it does to the downtown. And if something seems to work, keep it. If something didn't work because it was too low, maybe crank it up a bit, see who's affected. I don't like to single out people in the community and say, well, you know, you've been doing this category of, let's say, workers who commute and park their truck somewhere. I want to say, if you want to park your truck there and you want to pay $250 a year or $2,500 a year, go for it. Fund these other solutions. But the important thing is to price the convenience and the access in such a way that those who value it the most are paying for all these other solutions, the infrastructure, the hard stuff. And anyone else who doesn't like what's happening, the answer is, well, if you pay a bit more, you can ratchet yourself up to the next step on the ladder and have a bit more convenience. That I think, I am a victim of hanging around for 40 years in my work life with economists, most of them Chicago economists, so you'll see that reflected here. But I'm struck by how you can solve these problems with pricing, and I'm saying that we have 14 years to experiment with these and see what we can get to work.
I'll comment on it real quick. I think you're right. I think if we actually did charged for parking on street, there would be, you know, sort of other businesses that would create, you know, ways for people to get downtown. There'd be other people would take other ways to get downtown. If you knew I could park for 2 hours and it's free, the next hour is a buck, the next hour is two, then it's four, and if I sat there 8 or 9 hours for the day, it's a $40 bill, people would find some other way to do it. And it does, and you can't let people shift from one spot to another and start the day fresh. Once they've parked in there, they've parked in there. So if you did something like a system like that and valued the parking more highly, then I think, you know, that you would dampen the demand. Now, from a political standpoint, when you start talking about the high bidder gets to park, you know, gets the space whenever they want, there's half the electorate, two-thirds of the electorate wants to hang us, because you're saying the rich people get it and we don't get anything. And so whatever you do has to be fair. It has to be, hey, it's free for 2 hours and ratchet up a little bit. So, but in some of it, you have to start, you know, sort of start slow and build it. And it's not so easy to, you know, for 14 years, we can't, it's not easy to experiment, let's put it that way, because there's so much that has to happen, rules and, you know, and changing employees' perception, you know, of what their job is and how to do it, and then managing that. Those things, like a lot of these ideas are easy, you know, like running my business, you know, that, you know, I can write what it should be, but actually implementing it and getting people to do it the same way every day, that's really hard. The town has that same problem, you know, and so you can only change it, so you can only change it slowly, and if something's wrong, you can only correct it. You know, you correct two or three things, and then you've got, and then something else goes wrong. You have to correct that. So we really, I think, long story short, I think what you're saying in theory works, and we should be using more of it. But we have to have looked at the whole picture and have a good idea how it's all going to fit together.
Dave, did you want to comment before we go to our final audience member?
Yeah, I just a couple things. So I was down in Washington, D.C. probably 8 weeks ago. Maybe it was 10, it was around Christmas. And one of the things I found interesting was my niece works just at the edge of the Pentagon. And she has an app on her phone for the local parking garages. And it tells her which garage has parking spaces, tells her which floor, doesn't necessarily tell her which space. For every idea we have, technology is finally coming true. I liken it back, right? So for those in the room, back to Matt's story about how old you are, I'm coming up on 60. And so I got an IBM computer in 1983, and they brought it to my house, and I was all excited. And then I figured out that I didn't know DOS, so I didn't know how to use the damn thing. So the idea about having a computer in 1983, really, candidly, if you weren't a programmer, it was worthless. Somewhere in the middle of all that, Microsoft came out and made it easy so we could all figure out what we wanted. Then Apple came in competition, and they made it user-friendly. technology is there, and now they're finding through apps and so on, they're making it seamless so we'll use it. So what technology is going to bring us in the next 5 years is beyond our imagination. I believe that. So that will become part of what we choose for a solution. I will say, I think Matt brought up a point that I think is absolutely critical to the discussion. More than the absolute answer today, we need an owner on the island, a commissioner of transportation. Think about it right now. You have the steamship, which in many ways works independent other than one or two meetings a year. You have Highline, which works independently as they see their issues. You've got the NRTA, and Paula does a great job of trying to meet with people. Mike meets with people monthly, but again, they have their own interests. You have the airport that's solving their problem and looking at parking in their own vacuum. You've got taxi and their issues. You have state planning and federal planning that may or may not align, that selectmen may or may not have the time to be educated on. Having one voice that holds us all accountable, helps keep the glue together, would be the one thing I would urge the town to think about as a citizen, not as a representative of this project. The bigger something is, the more complicated, the more you need an owner that can help us stay focused on the right information. The only other question is, comment is really back to Peter. The 15 years, in our minds, is 15 years of working on the whole project. I would hope we have a direction sooner than 15 years as to we think this is part of a transportation solution. Because if it's not, then we need to get a sense of what it is we can do to help make this a better, more manageable issue.
Thank you. Dave, you're up.
Hello. Thank you. So my concern is more with long-term parking, not in terms of overnight, but it seems to me like in town, the limit is usually an hour to 2 hours. And I definitely think we want to encourage people to come to town, stay, shop at our businesses, really contribute to the town. And it seems like your number one idea for long-term access to town, besides parking in town, is the satellite, which I think is a cool idea, but like Mr. Morrison mentioned with the survey, how many people are actually going to use that? Because I know that the elementary school has been a satellite parking lot for years on the Nerda stop, and I don't really know how many people use that. I certainly don't. I love to drive to town and park, even though I could bike there in 10 minutes. So I was just wondering if you had any other ideas for maybe like all day parking or even just like 4 hours, something a little bit more accessible for people to really use the downtown area.
Yeah. Reactions?
Yeah, I think the 37 Washington Street lots, actually, you know, that's the intended utility of that particular lot is that there really is no time restriction other than the overnight restriction. So that's available to a lot of the community. The unfortunate side is that there's a limit to the size of that lot, and it's simply taken up by employees who get there first thing in the morning and take up those spots. What the transportation center could be is actually provide that extra surplus of parking, assign a value to that. Hopefully it's within a willingness to pay, but again, provide that convenience and price that convenience in a tolerable manner. So those are two options. And then obviously there's still the transit service. You know, I'm lucky. I live in a place that's very accessible to transit. So that's a 15-minute bus ride in the peak season for me. So that's very convenient. I use that a lot to go to the downtown. Just don't want to compete with the parking spaces. Those who it's a little less convenient, you know, citing parking ride lots in a way that could be convenient, right on the perimeter of downtown, or just a quicker bus ride away. Some people are willing to do that. So right now, your only solution right now is bus service and the 37 Washington Street lot, which is infinite. Expanding the parking opportunities, pricing it fairly, that could be an expanded opportunity for other people. But more and more of these satellite lots, more and more transit service on a year-round basis, not just in the peak season. Those are the solutions we're trying to embrace.
Okay.
One quick comment. I'm not a big fan of the satellite lots because I think Nantucket's so small that, A, it should be able to be covered by NRTA. And once people put the key in the ignition, they're going to drive in and take their chances. You know, everyone does that. So I think realistically, they work for, like, I think the satellites work for longer-term parking, or if there were a charge downtown, they might work for the employees, might drive to a satellite and go to town if it was $40 a day to park. But I don't think they're a solution, you know, sort of for a satellite. Look, people, visitors and people going down to have lunch are not going to go to satellite lot. So I think we have to be realistic of how they're going to be used.
You know, it's definitely a cultural. I think more and more people that it, once taxis and Uber and those kind of systems become, I'm a huge fan of Uber. it's just it, once you use it, it becomes more of a utility and a way of life. The culture does tend to change, and it becomes another very realistic choice and an option. And perhaps this transportation center can be a part of that as a parking opportunity for those kind of vehicles, those on-demand autonomous vehicles as time it goes on. That'll be the utility of that lot. But I agree. I think we're trying to get there and make it convenient for everybody.
One final comment.
I think it's great what you guys are talking about, and I'm trying to find out, you know, where's the consensus, and I think I've heard something a couple of times, and it rings true to me, is, and Matt brought it up first, is employers who allow their employees to come to town and park downtown all day. That's the biggest problem. I think, I mean, I counted the parking spots on my own one time. I thought there were 600. Well, there are more than 600 employees who work downtown. To Michael's point about the town parking lot at Washington Street, it's full by 9 in the morning, sometimes by 8:30 in the morning. A lot of those are town employees, but most of them are people who work in the community. If the employers could find a way to incentivize their employees not to bring their car to town and to recognize that, as John mentioned, it's a benefit to the retail people, it's a, you know, people are pulling up to a coffee shop or whatever it might be. If their employees aren't parking out front, guess what? Your customers can park out front. Well, who's the largest employer in town? Probably the town government, okay? There's a way to lead by example, is to say, you know, you say to your employees, find a way to incentivize them to park in the satellite spot at Fairgrounds or right over here at next door, and find a way to incentivize that so that it works and they take the shuttle. Because they come into work at 8 in the morning and they leave at 4. And their cars, we know where they're parked, on North Water Street all day long. And they take breaks. How many breaks do they take? So anyway, find a way for employers to incentivize their employees not to park in town all day long. And I think it would make a big step in the right direction. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And thanks to all of you for joining us. I also want to thank Nantucket Community Television, Channel 18, for filming this and reminding you that you can view this on demand probably within the next few days or so. Do not forget, if you're interested, to pick up a summary of the survey that Peter reviewed. They're on the table at the back of the hall. And finally, I want to thank our distinguished panel for their very, very informative presentations. It was excellent. Thank you all.